Whether it's the instrumentation, the use of the leitmotif, the choice among a complete theme, a rather ambient music, or no music at all, everything contributes musically to tell the story of Hollow Nest, its once welcoming places and its inhabitants condemned to wandering or blindness. This may seem more striking with bosses because there's often a theme associated with them, and an NPC will seem more eager to invade the game's lore, but all of Hollow Nest's places also participate in it. Let's take the example of the Royal Waterways. They're the sewers of Hollow Nest's capital city, but the water that keeps falling on the city has completely cleaned them out. The enemies populating these waterways have the appearance one would expect from sewer creatures. They are grotesque, some of them exploding like balloons under the blows of our nail. Deformed, disgusting. The boss of this area, the Duck Defender, one of the only two survivors among the five great knights, seems to have almost gone mad. He has made statues of his missing companions, as well as of the Pale King, a king idol at its feet. His laughter can be heard through the underground tunnels and throughout the fight.
Ooh, Aquamera, ha! Titros, come! Ico, Ico, Mara! Mera, Mera, Aqu! Rumas!
We've already talked about the Nailsmith, a recluse living near the waterways, unaware of the kingdom's decline. Rather than insisting on the grotesque character of these places, the music, played on a solo double bass, seems to convey the tragedy and loneliness that these characters are experiencing, locked up under the city, forgotten by everyone, having lost their former companions. Only the action layer, far too epic as we're bursting those balloons, makes fun of this grotesque ambience while Conifer sings with all the vigor he's capable of. The contrast is striking with the music of the City of Tears, another beautiful moment which highlights a full orchestra with solo oboe for the in-game music, but in the soundtrack the theme is sung by Amelia Jones, in a theme that develops at length in the high register, way of illustrating the greatness of this fallen kingdom's capital, where sentries and bourgeois now wander endlessly. It should be noted that the theme of the City of Tears is the one sung by Marissa in the Pleasure House. I have already talked about this extremely touching NPC, whose audience, enchanted by her voice, has now disappeared. She has become a ghost but keeps on singing, and choosing her theme is like speaking of the City of Tears as this city still standing but no longer really alive, inhabited by spirits and whose ancient clamor can sometimes still be heard in the Queen Station. Another area stands out thanks to its enemies having a rather charming appearance and sound effect, the Fungal Wastes. And there the music plays on this comic with elegance through the instrumentation, the leitmotif being played pizzicato. When we reach the Mantis village, the pizzicatos disappear, replaced by the strings arco, playing with a bow, and a discreet harpsichord. Any comical aspect disappears to show that the mantises are noble and formidable enemies, and the harpsichord will be furiously present in the fight against the Mantis Lords. Note that we also find the pizzicato strings, once again treated rather literally in a very pleasant way, in a very strange room where NPCs invite us to sit and rest as they seem to care for our well-being. Except that we enter the Beast's Den, where we discover one of the dreamers, Hera, Hornet's mother. In some areas, the themes develop at length or with assurance, while in others, the approach is more cautious. In the Queen's Gardens, a place that once belonged to Un, and which the Queen has completely claimed herself, there is no leitmotif. The harp has the main theme and very elegant touch, the harpsichord. It has already been heard associated with the mantises in their village at the bottom of the Fungal Wastes, and the Queen's Gardens are also home to praying mantises, those who succumbed to the infection led by the traitor lord brother of the Mantis Lords. Also, the oboe can be reminiscent of the City of Tears. What's also striking for me in this area is how much the music translates this life that goes on through the invasive vegetation, despite the stasis in which Hallowness finds itself. The accompaniment layer remains rather static, with the choir barely punctuated by a cymbal which maintains a pulse even in the rooms where there's only this layer, or later by an intervention of the oboe, the harpsichord or the strings. But at the main layer, those rather fast harp arpeggios and then the melody, and you have the perfect illustration of the Queen's Gardens, the expansion in spite of the kingdom's sleep. The White Lady lives secluded in a small cave just like her and has her own music, a harp solo. It can be noted that it is quite developed, even harmonically, much as her rather extended dialogue. This theme is logically shared by the two paid beings. In the most difficult area of the game, the White Palace, we face a very demanding platforming challenge requiring quite some stamina, lulled by the rather haunting music taking up the White Lady's theme, the royal theme so to speak, that had already been heard at the very beginning, in E minor, accompanying the verses of the Elegy for Hallownest. There are very few different keys in Hollow Knight. It is a dark adventure, which takes place mostly underground, so the choice of keys is limited and always very consistent. So we are always in C minor, as for the White Lady's theme. For the Queen, however, the treatment of the theme was intimate in its instrumentation, a harp solo, and rather soft, gentle, with its generously pronounced arpeggios and glissandos. But the White Palace is a place full of meaning, a place that suddenly vanished, a place we explore in a dream. Was the White Palace always partly in the dream realm? This isn't made clear in the game. What's more, it's in the dream of one of the king's molds, guards created for this place specifically. It's the symbol of the kingdom's greatness, of its secret and mysterious character as well, since the king lived there as a recluse, but its disappearance is a symbol of the tragedy that affected Hallownest and the impurity of the Hollow Knight, exposing the king's mistake. It is thus another instrumentation, an orchestra essentially focused on strings and woodwinds, rather transparent but which can also be rich and imposing, like the place itself. And it's also a different treatment of the theme. First, there's the light rubato of the harp, whose arpeggios slow down and then resume as we enter this sleeping place, punctuated by soft tremolos in the winds. The strings are very divided, while the most prominent element is a contrapuntal motif, but not yet the royal theme, in the lower strings. They are also very soft, sustained notes in the high register of the violin. This contrapuntal element in the lower strings takes up the duality I mentioned earlier, the ambivalence between this quest for the depths and the desire to go back to the surface. It is extremely simple, underlining our entering a new place, but this motif is descending. This place is fallen and its very existence has no real meaning. It will then try to go beyond the low register to linger for a long time on the leading tone, which calls for a resolution on the C, which finally comes as the royal theme is stated. Even if the harp doubles the theme, it's the oboe that states it, which allows for a phrasing that's different from the White Lady's theme, stronger, more tense too. As it's a woodwind, the note is sustained after the attack for the entire duration of the note, whereas for the harp, the note is attacked and immediately after you have a resonance. The theme itself is not changed, it's really the phrasing that does everything, the choice of the oboe. In addition to being narrative, the oboe is always heard when we're in places where the two-paid beings live or used to live. It's musically very beautiful, it is an instrument that projects very easily in the medium register. The repetition of the ascending fifth brings a lot of tension that is resolved on the reprise of the theme in a fuller instrumentation and with a new contrapuntal element. When the theme is taken up again, the attacks are very well chosen. As the harp systematically slows down at the end of the bar, the orchestra's attacks are not direct. The note sometimes seems to take a few moments to sort of settle, which underlines the dreamlike atmosphere of the place and accompanies the harp's rubato. Thank you. but the theme of decline is more clearly heard in the next part, with the systematic repetition of the famous descending motifs on the flute, I think, supported by the harp. The orchestra doesn't sound massive, the transition between the previous part and this rather iconic moment, for me at least, in the Hollow Knight soundtrack, could lead us to think that there would be a sudden outburst, but no, it remains very soft, yet well and truly desperate. The motif is short and therefore repeated 4 times or even 8, as it's in fact the same thing at 2 different octaves. I don't think that we could have had something too massive. Remember that this is a piece that we're supposedly here for quite some time, since the White Palace is a technical challenge and therefore requires a certain amount of time to be realized, at least the first time. It also requires concentration. The choice of a music that is powerful narratively, but not too powerful instrumentally, is perfect. The strings have a slower, lyrical, ascending motif, illustrating again the ambivalence of this place and of the whole work, before each in turn the woodwinds come to take up the initial arpeggios of the harp, sounding here like a speech that would never really end, or like an attempt that would always fail. Of course, something else is an integral part of this area, the sound design. What better way to accompany this music than with the sounds of saws and spikes? And what could be more confusing than those startled servants who bow at this odd little bug wearing the king's brand? At the end of the White Palace, when you're about to obtain one of the 2 precious white fragments, you can take the place of the pale king on his throne. A very soft music is then played on the harp. We recognize the vessel's theme on top of the king's. The rhythms are not changed, it is therefore a very beautiful detail to have made the 2 leitmotifs overlay perfectly when we know that the knight, like any vessel, is engendered by the union of the paid king's and the white lady's souls. The harp often represents the paid beings, especially the white lady. It is a way to grant the hero the rank of sovereign, which they have somehow already obtained after having recovered the king's brand before. In the previous video, I talked at length about the NPCs. Some of them obviously have their own music. It's the bosses. They're usually NPCs with whom you don't spend a lot of time, except for Hornet, for example, whom you chase in Green Path, fight twice and meet again several times, in scenes that are always moving when you understand her ties with Hollow Nest and the hero. So you have to show their personality very quickly and efficiently through movements and attacks, but also through the music, just like the little hero, few of them talk, at least before the fight.
Rumors!
One aspect of Hollow Knight I will come back to in the conclusion of this series is the variety of the emotions here. The story is tragic, but not without poetry or grotesque. The bosses also cover a wide range of attitudes and emotions, beautifully illustrated in the music. Some of the bosses are elegant, proud fighters who defend their territory and acknowledge the hero's abilities, like Hornet, boss of Green Path and later of Kingdom's Edge, or the Mantis Lords, optional boss of the Mantis Village at the very bottom of the Fungal Wastes. Both have themes with an elegant instrumentation, strings for Hornet and frenetic harpsichord for the Mantis. Their nobility can be heard in the music, which is completely treated literally, with, however, in the Mantis Lords, a jerky rhythm that skillfully translates their disconcerting attacks without being difficult, and their almost unpredictable entrances, in opposition to the very swift disc attacks illustrated by the flowing string motifs. The paid king's daughter takes up the very beginning of the royal theme, but in her own key, A minor against C minor and E minor for this theme usually, and with a very different development, as if to assert her independence and highlight her way of fighting, elegant and virtuoso, and her feminine voice by the choice of the violin. It's important because she's the king's only gendered child, as the white lady calls her. But the music of the fight against Hornet also translates the fight between the two characters. Certain fight for Hornet, hypothetical fight for the hero whose thoughts are always unfathomable by the replies between the instruments. Other bosses share a similar past but are yet treated with humor. Of course, I have in mind both the Duck Defender and the Hive Knight. For these two bosses, their themes take some distance with the nobility of the condition and emphasize their pleasant, even frankly comical aspects. The chivalrous aspect is immediately clear thanks to the instrumentation, which is similar in both cases. All the distinctive elements are present. The brass instruments have the main theme each time and are accompanied, as they should be, by percussion, especially the snare drum, which is quite military, and the piccolo. The strings don't have the main role, but are also present, essentially through very fast, furtive, stepwise motions associated with the boss movements. Mm-hmm. The xylophone, through its childish side, shows the distance taken with the knightly character of these NPCs. In the case of the Hive Knight, the solemn aspects of the instrumentation is clashed by the chromatisms in the theme itself and in the contrapuntal elements played by the strings and woodwinds, which evokes this boss's humming in an elegant reference to Rimsky-Korsakov. For the Duck Defender, it is the very sound of the brass instruments, less bright and slightly saturated. I don't think you have trumpets, sorry Defender. Which already clashes with the boss title, but even more so these very fast violin scales. The Duck Defender has indeed a peculiar way to move. He swims from one end of his arena to the other arena, which is made of, made of excrement, emerging regularly. He also turns into a ball and bounces around the arena. He's very fast and coming at us with balls of feces. This velocity translates into the frenetic stepwise motions on the violins. It really sounds and looks as if those were bouncing as much as the Duck Defender. For those two bosses, the rhythm also contributes to the humor. There are many syncopations and offbeat accents. The Hive Knight is given nice quarter notes triplets. Play three notes evenly distributed over two beats. And sometimes this brave boss seems to be losing his balance thanks to the quadruplets. Four notes evenly played over three beats, played at the same time than the quarter notes. There's humor in the sound too, like when the percussion coming after a fuller orchestra suddenly sound hollow, no pun intended. Or the possessed xylophone. For an even richer narration in the case of the Duck Defender, we can face him again in his dream version, the White Defender. The music of this boss logically takes up the initial theme of the Duck Defender, but since we are in Ogrim's dream, Ogrim is the Duck Defender's real name, only the nobility of his former function of Great Knight is emphasized. Remember, Ogrim was one of the Pale King's five Great Knights alongside Zemer, Triya, Isma and Egemol. The instrumentation is different, the xylophone is set aside, the woodwinds and strings are more emphatic. They no longer underline Ogrim's movements but participate in the very epic atmosphere with this initial ostinato, creating a nice background, translating the White Defender's effervescent character more than the Duck Defender's madness. The brass instruments become more imposing, which is also made possible by the rhythm, which is modified and amplified. Their long sustained notes highlight the counterpoint on the strings, the broken arpeggios that form a beautiful build-up, and the syncopations are used differently to make it more complex and elegant rather than to make fun of the defender. Percussion are also treated with more finesse, with the timpani in the transition. A choir discreetly accentuates the orchestra. The harmony, finally, is more complex. The piece is more elaborate, with a lyrical central part with the oboe, the solo instrument of the City of Tears, under which he lives, and the harp, the instrument often associated with the king and queen, as Ogrim used to protect the king. Was also a central part in the Duck Defender's theme, highlighting the woodwinds, but in a way that was comical more than elegant. While being very funny, let's be honest, I love the Duck Defender. The White Defender's theme is thus a very beautiful example of narrative virtuosity through music. But what about Zolt? There is no fighter more ridiculous than Zolt, whether in the Trial of the Warrior in the Colosseum of Fools or in Bretta's home in his dream form. Nothing in Zolt's dream combat theme, Truth, Beauty and Hatred, suggests his ridicule, yet undeniable. But we aren't in just any dream, we are in Bretta's dream. She has succumbed to Zolt's charm and doesn't see him making a fool of himself, so she offers him a magnificent theme, it must be said. A theme that brings out elements from the leitmotif. One of my favorite bosses is the Broken Vessel. It's a vessel, so they had a fate similar to ours. Rejected by the king, abandoned at the bottom of the abyss, they escaped from there but succumbed in the ancient basin. As we approach them, they are awakened by light seeds that infect them and now manipulate them as they please. It is a tragic fight because we're facing one of our siblings. The theme of the Broken Vessel is therefore the same as that of the knight. It is the original theme, the one that starts on the tonic. The key is in C minor again, as the first time we discover it in the menu. Better still, it is also on the viola that the theme is played, as for the hero, but in our lower register, we go down to low C, the viola's fourth open string. This may be a way to emphasize the age difference between the two vessels. Indeed, it seems that the vessels are actually aging. We see the Hollow Knight with the King several times in cutscenes, and they appear much smaller than on the memorial and when we face them. Our character is very small, which the NPCs don't fail to notice, while the broken vessel seems slightly bigger, older. Their voice is similar to that of the hero, but lower. Whereas the theme introduced in the menu announced the tragedy to come, the changed rhythm and the different phrasing, the theme is really exposed legato, while at the beginning it is more tranquillo and with a different bowing, sounds like a cry for help from the broken vessel. At the same time, the strings are very rhythmic but not as chaotic as in the False Knight, where the offbeat accents reflect the instability of the boss, who regularly falls, and very heavy, often using the beginning of the leitmotif, reminding us that the broken vessel here is possessed by the infection and that they have no control. The movements also show this, as they seem unrealistic, too fast. The broken vessel attacks the hero at lightning speed, project themselves above the ground. They swing back and forth as if possessed, emitting balloons of infections, and when stunned, the head is completely thrown back under the weight of the infection. There is a real duality in this boss that alternates fast phases with slow, heavy phases, as the music combines the relentless, most suffocating rhythm of the accompaniment with the scream of the broken vessel that translates physically after the defeat by a paw they stretch out towards the hero. Their eyes, hollow, we can see the background through them, become again black like the void, the substance from the abyss. And since they were born there, in the soundtrack we hear at the beginning of their theme a short excerpt from the Abyss ambient music. And the music of the Abyss, the place where almost all the vessels are, is the leitmotif, slowed down in the extreme. The boss whose destiny is the most tragic is undoubtedly the game's eponymous character, the Hollow Knight themselves. Chosen by the King as the perfect vessel, they share moments together and soon afterwards they are locked up in the Temple of the Black Egg, supposedly for eternity. It uses the key from the very beginning of the game, E minor, and of course it uses the leitmotif. It is treated here with an isochronic rhythm, only quarter notes, each note being accentuated as if to underline the horror of the Hollow Knight's fate. But what's even more striking is that only the very first notes of the leitmotif are used, and to me it's a way to show that they are limited to their sacrifice. In the first cutscene, or when they get the Void Heart, on the memorial, the eponymous character is only seen through their function, being the vessel. It's different for the playable character since they're always on screen, and although they're silent, they interact with a lot of NPCs, whereas the Hollow Knight is limited to their sacrifice, as their music is limited to the beginning of the leitmotif. Shortly after, the leitmotif is heard with a dilated rhythm, half notes instead of quad notes, while the strings on the verge of apocalypse, let's be honest, play descending then ascending stepwise motions in 16th notes, with repeated notes as a way to state even more powerfully this suffering, in which you could see the duality of the Hollow Knight, probably terrified by their fate, but nevertheless attacking the little hero who frees them from their chains. It's all the more intense that the strings are divided. While the high strings have descending motions, the low strings have ascending motions and vice versa, often acting as a mirror, almost perfect. This is very strong from a narrative, even metaphorical point of view, as the Hollow Knight finds themselves confronted with their sibling, their family. This whole first part is supported by a short ascending motif on the strings that starts again and again, obsessively. At that very moment, the music changes. One instrument after another, one voice after the other, it is a long build-up towards the end of the fight, where it seems that the music is screaming this suffering vessels aren't supposed to feel, even less express, during this phase where the Hollow Knight mutilates themselves, guided by the infection or their own will to end this pain they've suffered for who knows how many years. We also find this music in the most technical part of the game, the Path of Pain, a hidden area in the White Palace that contains a platforming section even more arduous than the White Palace itself, the challenge within the challenge. There, after long minutes, even hours of suffering, we witness a few seconds of the moments the king spent with his supposedly perfect creation, the Hollow Knight, as a child. Also, deep in the abyss, as we're about to obtain the Void Heart, the same music accompanies our long ascent towards the entry, and again we can see the Hollow Knight chosen by the Pale King, following him after a last look at the abyss. The main material is always the beginning of the leitmotif, but something changes when the solo violin comes in. Thank you. Again, the rhythm is modified, and now all the iterations of the motif are connected, whereas at the beginning of the fight they were almost only juxtaposed, creating here a real melody, as if to transcend, to sublimate this thematic element and illustrate the will of the vessel, of the two vessels even, one chosen by the king, the other one who succeeded in ascending the abyss and escaped from it, even though it was sealed. This will to be more than a function, while the choir takes up this short motif in its original rhythm, it could be an evocation of the other vessels which could not escape their sad fate, but musically accompany this attempt. It is all the more eloquent since here it is the violin that is used, not the viola. From the beginning, the vessel's instrument is the viola, and here the music frees itself from it, frees itself from the range of the viola and its tone, so beautiful but so dark that it would take us back to the depth of the abyss. When here the violin tries to develop on an already rather wide ambitus, a perfect 11th from E5 to A6, that is the high register of the instrument, and that it takes all the more time to cover as to each ascending element corresponds, again, a descending element, to emphasize the difficulty of this ascent. This part is played again, and of course the orchestration is more and more intense for an obvious build-up. But when the orchestra begins to join the solo parts, it already announces the tragic outcome of the little hero. Individuality becomes blurred. The solo violin be the Hollow Knight, the chosen one, caught up by the hero who makes them understand that they're not the only one being able to accomplish this feat, that they're not the only vessel. The tension of the augmented second announces the end of this ascent, and one hopes a victory. But the choir takes over, the leitmotif in its original form wins out. These voices without words sound like a lament while the infection remains, while the strings and then the brass instruments carry us away, by their descending motions imbued with a certain fatality here. Was there another way out, one thinks, since each note is accentuated? They carry us away towards the end of Hollow Knight. When the fight's over, the hero is now tied with those very chains from which they had freed the Hollow Knight. They now have to contain the infection. After a less spectacular musical gesture, a glissando played tremolo on the strings, the final sound effect almost creates a loop, since it's the same we had heard at the beginning when we got Conifer's map, and that we heard throughout the game as we were gaining power, without the piano notes, but it's the same shimmering effect.